Let's take a look at polarization today. So light is a form of electromagnetic radiation. That means it's composed of oscillating electric and magnetic fields. We would have a direction of propagation. And in this case, you can see our wave is propagating in this direction. And we're going to be talking about polarization. That means we're just going to focus in on the electric fields. We're not going to worry about the magnetic fields, the ones in blue. And we'd say that this particular wave, we would say that it was vertically polarized. The reason we know it's vertically polarized is that if I can draw a plane, a vertical plane right here, and inside that vertical plane, all of the oscillations of the electric field are contained. So because we've got a vertical plane that contains all the electrical field oscillations, we call that a vertically polarized wave. So anytime we've got polarized light, that means the electric field oscillations are in a single plane. Now that could be the horizontal plane, it could be the vertical plane, or it could be any plane in between. Now for unpolarized light, and most light is unpolarized, light from the sun, light from lamps, that's always unpolarized light. And it's going to oscillate in all the planes that lie along the direction of propagation. Going back to my animation, I can draw a plane, another plane right here, and I could imagine that we've got some sort of electric field oscillation in that plane as well. So we can have any plane in between the horizontal and the vertical plane as a possibility for polarization. If it's unpolarized light, that would mean that the electric field oscillations are in all of these different planes between the vertical and the horizontal planes. Now, how are we going to represent those planes? How are we going to draw polarized and unpolarized light? Well, this is how we draw unpolarized light. This would be the most complicated way of drawing it, and you can see all the planes. This here would be the direction of propagation. But that's kind of a difficult drawing. It's a 3D version. It's more complicated than we need. Now, a simpler drawing would be more like this second one, where we're showing lots of the planes in which the electric field is oscillating. And we have a direction of propagation, once again, coming out of the board. Now, in truth, we can simplify, and what we usually do is we simplify it to this drawing here, because all of the planes where the electric field can be oscillating can only have vertical or horizontal components. So we can just represent it with the horizontal and vertical directions. Now, the way that we usually get polarized light is to send it through a polaroid filter, and this would be the type of lenses that you would have on sunglasses. And it acts kind of like a picket fence. If I have a rope, then I can only do oscillations through a picket fence if those oscillations are in the same direction as the gaps in the fence. And in fact, if I've got two polarizers, the gaps both have to be in the same direction in order to get a wave that will continue through both polarizers. If I've got one of my fences on its side here and one of my fences being vertical, then there's no way that I can get any wave coming through here. That wouldn't be possible. And it's the same sort of idea with the polarizers. If I've got two vertical polarizers, I can get waves of light through. But if I've got one vertical and one horizontal polarizer, then I'll get blackness. No, all the light is going to be blocked if I've got one vertical and one horizontal polarizer. Or in fact, if I have any two polarizers that are at right angles to one another, then I'm going to get no light transmitted through. There's some other ways to polarize. So we mentioned the polarized filters. Another way is reflection from surfaces. You've probably gone to a lake, especially in the early evening when it's just about sunset, and light would come into the lake surface at a glancing angle and then reflect up, obeying the law of reflection. And what would happen is that this light coming in from the sun would be unpolarized light, but the light that reflects off would be horizontally polarized. And so when you have a pair of sunglasses, you'd like the filters to be vertically polarized so that this horizontally polarized light will be blocked out by the vertical polarization, and that will cut down on the glare that you receive. There's other ways, though, to produce polarized light. You can basically pass light through very thin slits, such as making scratches in glass. and that's done in liquid crystal displays. Quartz can also be used to polarize light, and you can also get some polarized light produced by scattering from certain gases. One of the kind of cool things about these polarizing filters is, let's say I've got a vertical polarizer here and another vertical polarizer here, then most of the light gets through, and you can see her mouth quite well with the two polarizers there. It's not quite as intense the light here as it is over here or over here, but some of the light is definitely getting through. Now in this second case, we've got a vertical polarizer here and a horizontal polarizer here, and you'll notice here it's dark. No light gets through at all. Now here's the interesting case. Okay, so on the front I've got the vertical polarizer, and at the very back I've got the horizontal polarizer. And so right in here you can see it's very, very dark. It's black here because it's just vertical and horizontal. But in between, what I've got is a polarizer that's polarized at an angle. And what you'll notice is that in here, where I've got the three polarizers, you still get some light being transmitted. And that's kind of a surprising result. How is it that a third polarizer can actually allow more light to be transmitted? So that's something that we'd like to explain, and we'd like to, in general, talk more about what happens to the intensity of light as it goes through a polarizer or through more than one polarizer. So we have this very fundamental question that we need to answer. How much of the light intensity, as the power per unit area, is lost as light goes through one or more polarizers? And let's start with the simplest case. Let's just have one polarizer, and we'll have some unpolarized light coming in. So here's our unpolarized light, intensity I naught, and it's going to go through a single polarizer. Let's say it's vertically polarized. It really doesn't matter. Then 50% of the intensity is going to be lost when that light goes through a single polarizer. So our intensity on the other side would be I naught divided by 2. I think it'll be easier to understand this 50% as we proceed ahead, but basically you've got two independent directions. So 50% of the light would go through each direction. Okay, let's suppose that we have two polarizers this time. We'd like to look at how much intensity is going to get through the second polarizer. So what we're going to do is we're going to start with some unpolarized light, and we'll give it an intensity 2 times I naught. And then we're going to pass it through a vertical polarizer. So this is a vertical polarizer. And so the light's going to come out with a vertical polarization. And then we're going to send it through a second polarizer, which we call the analyzer. And it's going to have a different axis of polarization. And a small portion of that light is going to get through to the other side. So the intensity of the light that gets through that first polarizer, we already said was half as much as came into it. So it's got to be I naught. And then we have to use what's called Malus's law here. And that'll tell us the intensity of the light that gets through the analyzer. And it turns out that I will be equal to I naught. That's the light that got the vertically polarized light that's incident on that analyzer, times the cosine squared of theta. This theta here is just going to be the angle between the polarizer axis. So if this is my polarizer axis, and this will be my analyzer axis, then there's an angle between those two. That's the angle theta that we're talking about. So that tells me how much intensity is going to make it through my analyzer. So let's look at what's going to happen. If theta is equal to 0 degrees, of course, 0 degrees is, of course, 1. So that would mean that I would equal I naught times the cosine of 0 degrees, which is just going to be I naught. In other words, if you send vertical light into a vertical analyzer, all the light makes it through. Now, if we make theta equal to 90 degrees, that would be a situation like a vertical polarizer and a horizontal analyzer. So we're expecting no light to get through, and that should be confirmed with our equation. I naught cos of 90 degrees. Cos of 90 is 0, so of course we get no intensity, no light makes it through. And then if we're halfway between that, we place our analyzer here at 45 degrees, so we're going to make this angle to 45 degrees, then we would get that I equals I naught cosine squared. I forgot to write squared here. Cosine squared of 45 degrees, and the cos of 45 is 1 over square root 2. That all gets squared. We've got an I naught out front. This will be 1 over square root squared. That's just going to be 1 half, so we're going to get I naught over 2. In other words, half of this light would make it through to the other side if you're at a 45 degree angle. Okay, what we'd like to do now is to derive this Malus's law here, which basically tells you what fraction of the energy of the light is going to make it through the analyzer. This representation here, it represents the size of the oscillations of the electric field. And that would mean that we could call this top part of the arrow here the amplitude of the electric field. And recall that the intensity varies as the amplitude squared. So that would mean that my initial intensity would be equal to some constant times my initial amplitude squared. When this light is incident on the analyzer here, the only part of the light that makes it through is the part, the component of the amplitude that is along the direction of the analyzer axis. So this is my analyzer axis right here. And this here would be my angle theta. That's the angle between the analyzer and the polarizer axis. This component here, well, it's a right angle triangle, so that component has to be x naught times the cosine of theta. What I can now say is that my intensity that passes through the analyzer, now the intensity of the light that makes it through the other side here has to equal this same constant that we were using before times the new amplitude all squared. And my new amplitude is just x naught cos theta. So I've got to square that, x naught squared cos squared theta. And then this is kx naught squared. Well, that's just my initial intensity. So there is Malus's law right there. And I also said that we'd use this to explain why it's possible if we have two polarizers and we send the light through the first polarizer, it's vertically polarized, nothing's going to get through the second polarizer. But I was saying that if we put an analyzer in the middle that is at an angle to the vertical, then we'll get some light transmitted. Let's see how that works. So here's the polarized light that gets through the vertical polarizer here. A component of that is going to make it through. So that would be this component here. And it would then try to get through this second analyzer. And only a portion of that that's along the axis would get through, which would be this green one. So we do get, in the end, a small amount of light that makes it through in this case. So here's a very typical IB question. Read it over and try it, and then come back for the answer. Unpolarized light of intensity I naught. So we've got I naught coming in here. Remember, as soon as it goes through that first polarizer, then here in between, our new intensity will be I naught all over 2. Now, on the second one here, what we've got to do is apply Malus's law, which means we would have to take this intensity and multiply it by the cos squared of theta. And that's going to be I naught all over 2. Cos squared of, well, the cos of 60 degrees is a half, so we're going to have to do a half and then square that. So we're going to get I naught divided by 8. And that means our answer, the answer you should have got, is D here. So key point on this question is not to forget that when the light passes through that first polarizer, it loses 50%. And then you can apply Malus's law when it goes through the analyzer. And that's all for today, folks. Thank you very much.